The date is October the 16th, 2015. A small school in Prairie Village, Kansas is home to a diverse range of students and student ideologies. A teacher of the school, known as Mr. Muhammad, wants to spark debate in the classrooms to help students get a better understanding of why they believe the way they do. On this date, a small classroom in Shawnee Mission High School would be home to one of the school's most racially charged, politically diverse, and online viral debates in the school's history. This was the Confederate flag debate, and this is where our subject comes in. Christopher Henry Justice. Allow me to preface this video by saying that I do not explicitly support any of the things that anyone says. My opinions are my own, and everything I say that has weight to it will be supported by facts and evidence. If there are any politically charged, hateful, or derogatory use of this video's comment section, your comment will be deleted. With that, if you're new, hit the subscribe button, ring the bell, and let's get into the video. At the start of the debate, as students piled into the cramped classroom, Mr. Muhammad set the stage for the debate.
He came to me a couple weeks back with the whole topic of the Confederate flag, which is absolutely a hot button topic right now, right? Like, especially after the situation that happened in South Carolina, you had a lot of people who were discussing, is it heritage or hatred, right? And in this school, we have people who have viewpoints on a variety of sides. So the goal of Rob and myself is to facilitate a community where we can have an open discussion that's civil. All right, so at this point, like, we're gonna open it up. I'm gonna ask questions, and anybody in here can speak, okay? But the rules of the debate are that you have to allow whoever's speaking to finish their thought. And there's not gonna be any winner or loser. I mean, I don't think that anybody here is gonna leave thinking whatever else different. Whatever you think is your opinion, and you are entitled to that opinion. But we wanna keep it respectful. We don't wanna get ratchet up in here. All right, we got Gandhi on the wall, for God's sakes. So what would Gandhi think if we got ratchet, right? Even though that word probably didn't exist when he was alive. So the idea of the Confederate flag for a lot of people is controversial. What I wanna know is your opinion. Do you feel that the Confederate flag should be allowed to be worn or flown publicly, specifically like at a school like East?
And so, the debate started. Mr. Muhammad made it clear, should the Confederate flag be flown publicly? With this historical question, the debate started. I won't show any of the other kids in this video because that is not what this video is about. One of the students that the teacher called upon was a senior who supported the public flying of the Confederate flag by saying that the flag didn't represent racism and was misunderstood by modern political historians. To the student who will remain anonymous for this commentary, as someone who is an aspiring history teacher, I've read countless first-hand sources from the higher political figures of the Confederate States of America and can confidently say that the Confederacy was about and for the institution of African-American slavery. According to the Declaration of the immediate clauses which induce and justify the secession of South Carolina from the Federal Union, because South Carolina was the first state to secede from the Union in the South, the Constitution of the United States in its fourth article provides as follows: no person held to service or labor in one state under the laws thereof escaping into another shall in consequence of any law or regulation therein be discharged from such service or labor, but shall be delivered up on claim of the party to whom such service or labor may be due. This stipulation was so material to the compact that without it, that compact would not have been made. The greater number of the contracting parties held slaves, and they had previously evinced their estimate of the value of such a stipulation by making it a condition in the ordinance of the government of the territory ceded by Virginia, which now composes the states north of the Ohio River. According to the Fourth Amendment of the Confederate Constitution, the citizens of the state shall be entitled to the privileges and immunities of the citizens in several states, and shall have the right to transit and sojourn in any state of this Confederacy with their slaves and other property, and the right of property in said slave shall not be thereby impaired. No slave or other person held to service or labor in any state or territory of the Confederate States under the laws thereof, escaping or lawfully carried into another, shall in consequence of any law or regulation therein be discharged from such service or labor, but shall be delivered up on claim of the party to whom such slave belongs, or to whom such service or labor may be due. And finally, the cornerstone speech from the Vice President of the Confederacy, Alexander Stephens. The prevailing ideas entertained by him and most of the leading statesmen at the time of the formation of the old Constitution were that the enslavement of the African American was in violation of the laws of nature, that it was wrong in principle, socially, morally, and politically. It was an evil they knew not well how to deal with, but the general opinion of the man of the day was that somehow or other, in the order of providence, the institution would be evanescent and pass away. This idea, though not incorporated in the Constitution, was the prevailing idea at the time. The Constitution, it is true, secured every essential guarantee to the institution while it should last, and hence no argument can be justly urged against the constitutional guarantees thus secured because of the common sentiment of the day. Those ideas, however, were fundamentally wrong. They rested upon the assumption of the equality of the races. This was an error. It was a sandy foundation, and the government built upon it fell when the storm came and the wind blew. Our new government is founded upon exactly the opposite idea. Its foundations are laid, its cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery, subordination to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition. This, our new government, is the first in the history of the world based upon this great physical, philosophical, and moral truth. This truth has been slow in the process of its development, like all other truths in the various departments of science. So, to deny that the Confederacy was about slavery is actively going against what historical documents say. That's where our representative, Christopher Justice, comes in.
Justice,
you do have a right to fly it. I do not think it should be flown on public property, like in front of a state house. You can also fly it at protests. But he mentioned misconceptions. There are no misconceptions about that flag. The flag that we see today is not actually the Confederate flag. The Confederate flag is similar to that of the United States. It has a blue upper right-hand corner with seven stars in a circle, two red stripes, and in the middle a white stripe. The flag we see today is an interpretation of a Confederate battle flag. And the interpretation went up in the 1960s, around the time the Civil Rights Movement started, and to the point where it's not racially motivated. Then how come it's a symbol for so many groups like the KKK and the National Socialist Movement, who, as you all probably know, have white supremacist and neo-Nazi ideologies? Also, I find it ironic that people claim to be patriots when they fly that flag. The Confederates stabbed the Union in the back. They shot first. They murdered 500,000 American soldiers. And they argued that it was because of states' rights. I ask, states' rights to do what?
In one fell swoop, an absolute banger of an opening statement, Chris provides means, morals, and motivation for why the South seceded from the Union. To put it in layman's terms, the South wanted to secede from the Union, the United States, because someone they didn't like, Abraham Lincoln, was elected president. They also wanted to expand the institution of slavery westward to provide more profit for the Southern economy. The reason why the North retaliated to this notion is that slavery was making the entire country look harsh in the eyes of the rest of the world. Hence, the Civil War. Christopher Justice is an underappreciated YouTuber with just over 2,000 subscribers by the time that I'm making this video. He got his online fame through his high school newspaper's YouTube channel, The Harbinger, capitalizing on the success of his debates and discussions in high school. He took to YouTube by uploading Harry Potter fanfiction? Yeah, so apparently Chris wanted to read a Harry Potter fanfiction called My Immortal because it is widely regarded as the worst fanfiction of all time. He managed to make 15 episodes of the series to entertain his viewers and provide comfort for those who were scared during the time of the first rise of the coronavirus. Afterwards, he went solo until... Well, everybody, I've started filming my next video. Don't expect anything fancy. Just me and my webcam, mostly. Hope everyone is doing well and staying safe. The King! Marx's beard! He's returned! Christopher Justice returned to YouTube after half a year of absence on the platform to make a video debunking the Sons of Confederate veterans. As he was about to get started, two characters showed up. These characters represented Chris's ego. Populist Chris was Chris's right-wing side, and Syndicalist Chris was Chris's left-wing side. The two parties of Chris's ego came back from the sands of time to derail the video that Chris had planned to make for months on end. As a result, this first video would be a lecture with comedy skits sprinkled in about how, because we refuse to seek knowledge, then we will forever remain uneducated in nuance. 2 months go by as Chris is working hard on the second video of the series entitled Revolution, Counter-Revolution, March Madness, and Confederates. In this video, Chris and his alter egos debunk the Our Dixie video from the Make Dixie Great Again YouTube channel. This video was filled with flowery language and empty platitudes to make uneducated people who don't know about the true Southern history feel good about the fact that tens of thousands of people died for a lie. A lie that the Confederacy had nothing to do with slavery. The lie that men fought and died for something they believed in. In reality, they were forced to idolize the Confederacy because if they didn't, they would be killed by the Confederate higher-ups who were too lazy to pick their own damn cotton. I won't go into the detail on the video because Chris's video will be in the description. But the man in the video celebrating the Lost Cause narrative said that people in Massachusetts owned slaves longer than the people in Louisiana. Never mind the fact that Massachusetts was a state long before Louisiana, and that they ended slavery 2 to 3 decades before Louisiana would ever come to a state. Like I said, empty platitudes with no base evidence. For a party who claims to be facts over feelings, they sure do have to do some Olympic-level mental gymnastics to get around the fact that an entire race was denied basic human rights. Many people like Chris and myself are infatuated with history. We love getting history right. So when someone says that factual evidence of what a group of people did during a certain period is wrong, don't blame us when we get a little crooked-eyed from the sheer stupidity that's coming out of their mouth. Regardless, Christopher represents something bigger. He's not simply someone who's making videos for the sake of preserving history. Chris represents a group of people who want to see their country do better. For far too long, America has been divided on class, income, and now, thanks to Confederate apologists, region. Frankly, this populistic attitude towards this country, my country, is hurting the very foundations of what this country was built on. If you don't believe me, then look at the Capitol riots. Not only is it hurting the political infrastructure of this country, but it's also tearing apart the moderate base of American discourse as people become more and more divided with every passing year. Christopher Justice, just like me, went through a right-wing phase when he was younger. So did I. We pretty much believed the same things. We unironically used words like social justice warrior and liberal as insults. We thought that American universities were deliberately turning kids into communists, and probably the most damaging to our psychological health. We thought that Black Lives Matter was a race-based nationalist group. To quote Christopher Justice,
I know, very stupid, and not a day goes by that I don't beat myself up over it.
Unlike people who perpetuate the spreading of misinformation, people like me, Christopher Justice, Hunter Avalon, Vosh, and many others all have something that these people lack the function to grasp the concept of. Maturity. We grow up. We look back at our younger selves and think, why were we so angry back then? The reality is, Every kid, for whatever reason, has this inane want to be part of something bigger than themselves. Hence why kids tend to lean towards far left or far right ideologies. But eventually, with time, patience, education, and most importantly, maturity, we always find the middle ground and work to compromise, not to make America great again, as the Orange Man puts it. Side note, that man is his own minority group. Seriously, how many orange people do you see walking around these parts? God bless these populace. But to make America revolutionary again. Chris is a good guy. I highly suggest you go subscribe to him. His channel link will be in the description. And Chris, if you're watching this for whatever reason, thank you for helping me out of a dark time in my life. The Confederacy was made up of a group of rich white Southerners who hated the fact that someone they didn't like was elected president. Instead of coming to common ground and protecting the sanctity of democracy, the vast majority of the South decided to throw their toys out of the pram and pout as they all collectively left the Union. They would form a new nation, a nation of prosperity for landowners, and a nation that deprived poor white workers and African American slaves of their basic human workers' rights. This country would be called the Confederate States of America. And it would only last 4 years. Get dunked on, you neo-Nazi bat. The Civil War was a war about slavery. Anyone who claims to defend the Confederacy under any circumstances is either a racist or uneducated. Speaking of uneducated, a lot of defenders of the Confederacy like to say that because Jefferson Davis, the president of the CSA, took in a black child, that somehow dismisses the millions of other black people that were kept in chains and bondage. They were nice to kids once. That makes it okay. I'm not racist because I have a black friend. A little word of advice for you people. If you don't want to be compared to Nazis and fascists, stop using the same arguments as Nazis and fascists. When addressing slavery during this time, it is important to note that most Northerners weren't opposed to slavery until they were exposed to it through the Union Army advancing into the Confederate States. Most Northerners didn't care about stopping the institutions of slavery, they just wanted to stop the expansion westward because, as I said in the beginning of the video, it was making the whole country look harsh in the eyes of the rest of the world. It was only until they got up close and personal and saw the horrors as children were beaten and starved, women were used as sex slaves, and men were shot, hanged, lynched, beaten, and spat on. The Union came into the slave plantations with the same expression as the American Army went into the Nazi concentration camps with. Horror. At that point, Abraham Lincoln knew he had to do something, that something had to be done. He gave countless speeches talking about how he hated the indifference to slavery, how no good moral Christian man can hold someone in bondage, strip them of their rights, and still call themselves a good man. How slavery would be the one thing that would tear this country apart by the seams. Abraham Lincoln proposed an amendment, the 13th Amendment, which would amend slavery from the property article in the 10th Amendment. One man, a humble man, stood at the crossroads. Would this man choose what was right for the future of the United States? Or would he do what his population wanted him to do? This man was George Yeaman, a Kentucky representative. When asked whether he would want to ratify the 13th Amendment, there was a long pause. The chief legislator asked again, "Sorry, Mr. Yeaman, I didn't hear your vote." Yeaman responded, "I said aye, Mr. McPherson. Aye." And so, with thunderous applause from the left wing and booing and hissing from the right wing, slavery would be no more, all thanks to one man. Despite the general consensus of the day being that slavery was an evil that needed to go, and the Confederacy were a group of traitors who stabbed the Union in its back, why do we still have people flying Confederate flags? Why do people still sympathize with one of America's biggest enemies? The answer lies in education. Many people can't come to terms with the fact that their ancestors were racists. If they weren't racists, and fought in the Confederacy anyway, then they were told that they would be fighting for states' rights, when in reality, to quote Alexander Stevens, this was an error. As someone who's from the South, I've come to terms with the fact that my ancestors were probably white supremacists. That doesn't mean that I'm a white supremacist, it's just a fact of history that I've come to terms with. I learned from the past so that I'm not doomed to repeat it. Other people who were from the South or have some sort of Confederate blood in them say that their family members didn't own slaves. They were fighting with the Confederacy to protect their farms. To those people, I asked a rhetorical question. In World War II, when Germans saw the Allied powers of France, England, and America come to Germany to rid them of the Nazis, do you think that they were looked on as invaders? Or Yankee thugs trying to impose the will on the people? No. They were looked on as liberators. The same way that the Union was looked on during the Civil War. Many people were ecstatic to see the Boys in Blues come protect them from an evil agricultural government. These Southern civilians helped African American people escape from plantations and join the Union Army. In the song, Battle Cry of Freedom, there's a line that says, "We'll fill our vacant ranks with a million freedmen more," which is a reference to liberating slaves from plantations that your ancestors, who weren't civilians, they were members of a tyrannical army, fought to protect. The reason why so many people still support the Confederacy is that they don't know of the horrors that these people caused. These weren't dashing rebels fighting a group of tyrannical people. These were boys sent off to war to die for some rich Southerners who were too lazy to pick their own cotton. And groups like the Sons of the Confederate Veterans are using these men's corpses to gain political power. This isn't the American way. For the sake of patriotism, let these men rest. They were caught up in something bigger than themselves and didn't understand what they were fighting for. People like Christopher Justice play an important role in American discourse. Thanks to people like Christopher, a gate has been opened so that more people can speak about the horrors that took place in the South during the 19th century. Christopher Justice was just some kid who was really passionate about history and decided to use his love of history to spark a small chasm of change on the internet. The Confederacy didn't secede from the Union because of states' rights. If they did, then it was about the states' rights to own slaves. The Confederacy was for and built on the institution of slavery. The Union didn't even want to stop slavery, they just wanted to stop the expansion of slavery westward. It was only until they reached the slave plantations in the South where they realized what was truly going on. Millions of African Americans were denied their basic human rights just so Jefferson Davis had enough money to masturbate with. Modern defenders of the Confederacy aren't defending their heritage, they're defending a government that oppressed their heritage and forced them to fight for something they didn't believe in. The moral that we should be taking away from this is the transitive property of equality, that things which are equal to themselves are equal to others. The Confederacy was a rejection of the American Revolution. It was a counter-revolution that spat in the face of every Republican, ideological, not political, who stood for freedom, liberty, and justice for all. We have come so far in subjects like math, science, technology, but for some reason we still hold on to petty rivalries over things we didn't live through. And some people try to force that fact onto other people to try and disavow its historical significance, Candace Owens. To deny what actually happened during this time is the same as saying that it didn't happen at all. It is a crying shame when we have historical textbooks being read to our children about how brave and noble the South was. It is not the job of the educated to push their notions onto the uneducated. Not everyone who is uneducated is a bad person, and even if they are, that isn't their own fault. They are a victim of the system. A system that claims to be against fake news and misinformation while actively spreading misinformation. These are troubled people. These are people who we need to help. To the people at the Sons of Confederate Veterans and the United Daughters of the Confederacy, your ideologies are based on feeling, not fact. You perpetuate the lost cause narrative to keep Americans ignorant and uneducated about what went on during the Civil War. The reality is people like me, Christopher Justice, and many other aspiring historians have read what your Constitution and your Vice President had to say about slavery and African Americans during this time. You're wrong. You're wrong about states' rights, you're wrong about the War of Northern Aggression, you're wrong about slavery and its impact on African Americans. Most importantly, you are wrong about what the Confederacy stood for. You people have warped history to fit your own narrative. You have done this. Everything that has happened relating to civil rights, minority protections and societal justice, you were the one who caused that. You made your bed, and now you're too scared to sleep in it because you're trying to mess it up again. The truth is you don't hate people who oppose the Confederacy. You're scared of them. You're scared of the fact that they seem to be more educated on a subject that you claim to be the experts on. Ironically, you act like regionalists who only honor Southern veterans who fought in the American Army while you praise the army that the Americans fought against. Men like Alvin York and Artie Tatum fought for their country dutifully and flagrantly opposed the support of the Confederacy. Even your idolized figures don't even support you. Instead of keeping this facade of fake Southern heritage, why don't you move on from it? The South has so much potential. As someone who lives in the South, we have beloved institutions that better represent our culture than the Confederacy ever did. Things like food, music, sports, entertainment. Take Tennessee, for example, my home state. We are the home of Elvis Presley. We have a country opera house called the Grand Ole Opry, where the best music performers in the world play at. Not to mention sports teams like the Vanderbilt Commodores, Tennessee Titans, the Tennessee Vols, and the Chattanooga Mocs. And the Nashville Predators. Oh, and the Memphis Wolves, our NBA team. Why can't we take this Southern pride and put it into something healthy? We have unlimited potential knocking on our shoes, and yet we cowered away to reach further and further back for something that means nothing to anybody except for us. As a Southerner, I know we can do better. This isn't me trying to push my own political agenda. This isn't me trying to force anyone to think a certain way. This is me telling the truth. It's a harsh truth that many people don't want to hear. But you know what? That's the beauty of the United States. That's the beauty of what the Union fought the Confederacy for. Is that people have the freedom not to listen to what others tell them. A freedom that the Confederacy tried to deny. A freedom that the Confederacy fought against. We hold the power of change in our hands. Instead of pushing it away, we should embrace it. In closing, Christopher Justice is the reason why I made this long video. I grew sick and tired of seeing the willing spread of misinformation and wanted to do something about it. This, although may not be significant, was that something. I hope that someone can take this and use it to spread true knowledge. Because without it, those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it.
Okay. If we're the United States, then why do you fly the flag of 11? Then why are?
Okay.
Then why do people fly the flag of a group of people that betrayed us and tried to leave? Secondly, we're not saying that you can't fly it. We're asking you to think before you do it, and understand that people might be offended, and. As you may say that you have the right to fly the Confederate flag, well, go ahead. We also have the right to burn it.